This is Barry Zelma, Zelma on Insurance. I'm an attorney who has retired from the practice of law and now spend my time as an insurance claims consultant and expert witness and author and producer of these videos. Today, I'd like to talk about the historical basis of punitive damages. The award of punitive-type damages was common in early legal systems and was mentioned in religious law as early as the Book of Exodus. Punitive-type damages were provided for in Babylonian law nearly 4,000 years ago in the Code of Hammurabi, in the Hittite Laws of about 1400 B.C., and in the Hebrew Covenant Code of Mosaic Law of about 1200 B.C., and even in the Hindu Code of Manu of about 200 B.C. The Book of Exodus, for example, in the Old Testament provides, quote, "If a man steals an ox or a sheep and kills it or sells it, he shall pay 5 oxen for an ox and 4 sheep for a sheep. He shall make restitution if he has nothing, and then he shall be sold for his theft. If the stolen beast is found alive in his possession, whether it is an ox or an ass or a sheep, he shall pay double." This is Exodus 22:1. The punitive damages remedy, therefore, has a very long history. It was first articulated in England in a case of illegal entry. The jury was held justified in going beyond the small injury done to the plaintiff because of the desirability of taking account of a most daring public attack made upon the liberty of the subject through entry and imprisonment pursuant to a nameless warrant. By the mid-1800s, as punitive damages increasingly became an established part of American tort law, American courts emphasized the punishment purpose of punitive damages. For example, in Hawk v. Ridgway, an 1864 decision from the Illinois Supreme Court, it concluded that where the wrong is wanton or it is willful, the jury is authorized to give an amount of damages beyond the actual injury sustained as a punishment and to preserve the public tranquility. Justice Scalia of the United States Supreme Court noted in a concurring opinion that in 1868, therefore, when the 14th Amendment was adopted, punitive damages were undoubtedly an established part of American law of torts. This was a decision in Pacific Mutual Life versus Haslip, a 1991 decision of the U.S. Supreme Court. At common law, the jury determined the amount of punitive damages. The trial judge conducted a limited review to determine whether the jury's verdict was the product of passion or prejudice, or whether the award was one that shocked the conscience. Historically, punitive damages were imposed to further a state's legitimate interest in punishing unlawful conduct and deterring its repetition. States necessarily have considered flexibility in determining the level of punitive damages that they will allow in different classes of cases and in any particular case. Most states that authorize exemplary damages afford the jury similar latitude, requiring only that the damages awarded be reasonably necessary to vindicate the state's legitimate interest in punishment and deterrence. Only when an award can fairly be categorized as grossly excessive in relation to these interests does it enter the zone of arbitrariness that violates the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment. Later decisions found a variety of rationales for assessing punishment damages in a tort action, including redressing affronts to personal feelings not susceptible of measurement, financing the cost of deserving litigation where only small compensatory damages can be expected, diverting the plaintiff's desire for revenge into peaceful channels, or serving as punishment for and deterrence from socially disapproved conduct. Typical of the torts for which such damages may be awarded are assault and battery, libel and slander, deceit, seduction, alienation of affections, malicious prosecution, and intentional interference with property such as trespass, private nuisance, and conversion. Punitive recovery usually arises from intentional torts with a single victim. The alleged deterrence achieved by punitive damages awards is often outweighed by the costs to the public at large, such as the encouragement of unnecessary litigation and the chilling of desirable conduct flowing from the rule. This was especially true when the standards of which the awards of punitive damages were based on ill-defined materials or not defined at all. When a defendant contends correctly that punitive damages are generally a windfall to plaintiffs who are entitled to receive full compensation for their injuries, but no more, one court concluded that assuming that a punitive fine should be imposed after a civil trial, asked that the penalty should go to the state, not to the plaintiff, who by hypothesis is fully compensated. Moreover, although punitive damages are quasi-criminal, imposition of punitive damages is unaccompanied by the types of safeguards present in criminal proceedings. This absence of safeguards is exacerbated by the fact that punitive damages are frequently based upon the caprice and prejudice of jurors. Punitive damages are authorized in almost every state, and the following are how each state, including Guam and the U.S. Virgin Islands, deal with punitive damages, and they vary from Alaska, Alabama, Arkansas, Arizona, California, Colorado, Connecticut, District of Columbia, Delaware, Florida, Georgia, Guam, Hawaii, Iowa, Idaho, Illinois, Indiana, Kansas, Kentucky, Louisiana, Massachusetts, Maryland, Maine, Michigan, Minnesota, Mississippi, Missouri, Montana, Nebraska, Nevada, New Hampshire, New Jersey, New Mexico, New York, North Carolina, North Dakota, Ohio, Oklahoma, Oregon, and Pennsylvania and Rhode Island. The right to punitive damages is not unlimited. The U.S. Supreme Court has clearly stated that, quote, punitive damages may be properly imposed to further a state's legitimate interest in punishing unlawful conduct and deterring its repetition, often exceed the fines assessed by the state if the same person had acted criminally to damage the plaintiff. This was stated in BMW of North America versus Gore by the U.S. Supreme Court. However, in 2003, the U.S. Supreme Court put limited punitive damages in the United States when in State Farm Mutual versus Campbell, they overturned a $145 million verdict against an insurer. The Supreme Court concluded that a punitive damages award of $145 million, where full compensatory damages were only $1 million, is excessive and violates the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment. Justice Kennedy, writing for the majority, limited the ability of state and federal courts to award huge punitive damages awards and concluded that it was improbable that a punitive damage award more than a single-digit multiplier of the compensatory damages award would seldom, if ever, pass the due process test. The Supreme Court in BMW of North America versus Gore set forth specific tests that must be met before punitive damages could fulfill the requirements of due process. In State Farm versus Campbell, that case arose out of an automobile accident where one party was killed and another severely injured. The Campbells, insured by State Farm, attempted to pass six vehicles on a two-lane highway, failed, and caused the driver of an oncoming car to drive off the road to escape collision with the Campbell's vehicle. The Campbells only had $25,000 coverage per person and $55,000 in the aggregate. The Campbells felt they were not at fault because there was no contact between the two vehicles. State Farm ignored the advice of its adjuster and counsel to accept policy limits demands and took the case to trial. The verdict at trial was more than $180,000, and the State Farm counsel told the Campbells to put their house on the market since they would need the money to pay the verdict. State Farm refused to pay the judgment and to fund an appeal. The Campbells retained personal counsel to pursue an appeal that was not successful, entered into a settlement with the plaintiffs where the plaintiffs agreed to not execute on their judgment in exchange for an assignment of 90% of all the money received in a bad faith action by the Campbells against State Farm. Before suit was filed, State Farm paid the full judgment. At trial, the plaintiffs brought in evidence of actions of State Farm in first-party cases across the country, in third-party cases not even similar to Campbell's auto accident, and other evidence not related to the facts of their case. The Supreme Court found that State Farm's handling of the claims against the Campbells merited no praise, but concluded a more modest punishment could have satisfied the state's legitimate objections. Instead, this case was used as a platform to expose and punish the perceived deficiency in State Farm's operations throughout the country. However, a state cannot punish a defendant for conduct that may have been lawful where it occurred. State Farm versus Campbell created a major precedent-changing limitation on the right of a jury to assess punitive damages, settling limits on total amounts that can be assessed and the type of wrongful conduct a jury can consider. In Nickerson versus Stonebridge Life, a 2013 decision of the California Court of Appeal applying the California Supreme Court precedent in Simon versus Sao Paulo U.S. Holdings, a 2005 decision of the California Supreme Court, was asked to deal with a punitive damage award the trial court found to be excessive. The sole issue raised by both parties concerned the punitive damages award, specifically whether the trial court's remitter of that award from $19 million to $350,000, based on a ratio of punitive to compensatory damages of 10 to 1, comported with due process. The trial court ruled that a policy provision limiting coverage was not conspicuous, plain, and clear, and was therefore unenforceable, entitling Nickerson to $31,500 in additional benefits under the policy. A jury then found that Stonebridge had breached the implied covenant of good faith and fair dealing and awarded Nickerson $35,000 in compensatory damages for emotional distress. The jury found Stonebridge acted with fraud and fixed the punitive damages award at $19 million. The trial court conditionally granted Stonebridge a new trial unless Nickerson consented to a reduction of the punitive damages to $350,000. Both parties appealed. Stonebridge insured Nickerson under a policy providing coverage for hospital confinement, intensive care unit confinement, and emergency room visits. Stonebridge agreed to pay indemnity in the amount of $350 per day for each day of confinement in a hospital for a covered injury, and $350 a day for each day of confinement in a hospital intensive care unit. The policy was not a health care policy. The insured was free to use the funds in any manner he or she wished, that is, for rent or even a car payment. The court concluded that the amount of punitive damages offended due process under the 14th Amendment as arbitrary, and concluded that when determining the constitutional maximum for particular punitive damages awards under the Due Process Clause, the courts are directed to follow three guideposts. 1. The degree of reprehensibility of the defendant's misconduct. 2. The disparity between the actual or potential harm suffered by the plaintiff and the punitive damages award. And 3. The difference between the punitive damages award by the jury and the civil penalties authorized or imposed in comparable situations. As a result, the trial court was directed to modify the judgment by reducing the punitive damages award to $350,000. This video was adapted from my book, Insurance, Bad Faith, and Punitive Damages Desk Book, which was published by the Full Court Press and is available on fastcase.com and at the fastcase.com bookstore. If you found this video to be interesting or useful to you, please refer it to your colleagues, and please follow or subscribe to my YouTube channel, my Rumble channel, and my blog so that you can be advised of future videos and future blog postings. Thank you for your attention.